The Racing Pod
on Off the Ball
with William Hill. Best odds guaranteed on all Irish and UK racing. 18 plus. See gamblingcare.ie.
And you're welcome to episode 52 of the Racing Pod on Off the Ball with John Duggan and Johnny Ward. Remember, we're here every week with interviews, analysis, race previews, tip stories and the crack. The first half of the pod each week is free to air. The second part is exclusively for members. So be sure to sign up by going to offtheball.com/join now. This week for members, we're going to focus on Saturday's action at Haydock and Ascot and also get Johnny Ward's charity bet. So subscribe now. Johnny, how is the form? I saw you were at Dundalk during the week.
I was. Dundalk is going to be a stable diet for the Wednesdays over the winter. I love Friday nights at Dundalk. And it's funny, like, the opportunities that these horses need, like big fields all the time. And, you know, a lot of the low-grade horses still stay in training. And for the flat jockeys as well, this is a great opportunity for them to keep going throughout the winter. You know, you go to Dundalk, all the top jockeys were there. Probably won't get so much of Ryan Moore, I would have thought, over the winter, but he goes there, like, in the main season. But, I brought this up before, JD. Like, the 35-minute gaps are a killer, like, at a race meeting, where if you're going to watch Dundalk, so the race might take place over a minute, minute and a half, and there's a 35-minute gap. And over an eight race card, that's over 4 hours. Now, this sounds like somebody giving out who works there and wants to go home earlier, which I do. But like, they really are killing these meetings when you're doing nothing. And the betting ring is dead nowadays. So you go up. What are you going to do for the half hour between races?
We're delighted to say we got the former jockey, current broadcaster, and William Hill ambassador Jane Mangan's on the line. Jane, how are you?
That Johnny's just said about 35-minute gaps. I really am relishing the prospect of having a 35-minute gap to build up the John Durkin and even to dissect the John Durkin post-race. But really, on a regular race day, I think anybody who's implementing a 35-minute gap, whether it's a regular Thursday at Thurles or a Clonmel on a Wednesday, they're obviously not attending the meetings.
And try it at a flat meeting, Jane.
I have. When you have 5 and 6 furlong sprints at Nason, the Curra, and it's hammering down rain and Tapia, there's just no fun in that.
Yeah, like I know, JD, that it's to suit the off course and that they are ultimately paying the bills, right? But if people don't go racing anymore, and there's absolutely no way I tell somebody to go racing on a flat meeting with 35-minute gaps unless it was like a grade one day. It sucks the life out of you. The betting ring, which was such a massive part of it, is effectively dead now. There's no theatre there. So what are you doing for the 33 minutes between racing? So I really feel we do need to look at this because it's killing the life. It's killing the soul of a lot of meetings.
So we're starting off with a bit of ranting, Jane, this week. How long is enough? 20 minutes enough?
Look, I'm all for the rants because he's actually just saying what a lot of people are thinking. And some of them are too afraid to say it out loud, but not on Off the Ball.
Yeah, and like it's as Jane says, if you're building up to a big race like the John Durkin, 40 minutes is grand. Like you've basically a full field. You want to see the horses, all the hype and the bettering even for that, but not for the regular stuff.
I'm looking at Punchestown this weekend, Jane and Johnny. It's ice cream, it's chocolate cake, it's whatever you want. It's absolutely fantastic that we're going to have the Morgiana Hurdle and the John Durkin chase with such great storylines to them. Let's just get into Saturday first then. Just get straight to it, Jane. State Man, champion hurdle winner at Cheltenham last March, has won 12 out of 13 starts when completing. William Mullins trains, and William Mullins also trains the mare Lassie Mouth, only beaten once in her life. They're going head to head. Would love to have seen that last March. We're going to see it tomorrow at Punchestown, the Morgiana Hurdle.
Yeah, and throw in Brighter Days Ahead as well, who's only £3 inferior to Lassie Mouth and has the benefit of a run this season. This is a proper race. It's not your typical Morgiana where you just expect it to be a procession for State Man. I think he's actually going to get tested. Now, 8 runners, 5 of them from his own camp. It does look as though the main threat lies from within. I find it fascinating. We're going to touch on this with the John Durkin as well, but I do believe that the prolonged dry spell has forced the hand of these big, big horses because we're now 4 weeks to Christmas. And if you want to go to Leopardstown or go to Kempton, you're going to have to get a run in. And this is probably why Lassie Mouth is turning up here. And this is probably why Brighter Days Ahead is turning up here. It's always been the starting point for State Man and everybody knows that. But do you come here or do you go to the Fighting Fifth next week? They obviously wanted to play a home game. They didn't want to travel the first day out. And while I admire the mares, I honestly don't think they'll beat the horse. I think he's going for his 11th grade one, right? So I can say superlatives, he's a good horse, he's this, he's that. He's going for his 11th grade one. And that tells you all you need to know. He's probably the most consistent horse in training, and he's consistent at grade one level.
Who's going to set the pace, Jane?
Dave Mann will make all.
I don't know about that, Jane, will he?
They can do what they want. He's so tactically versatile. They can do what they want. They can sit in his tail. They can box him in. They can do whatever they want. It won't matter. I think Glossy Mouth will be ridden for pace. I think she has a potent turn of foot. I think Brighter Days Ahead, her jumping it down Royal left plenty to be desired. I think she's going to actually benefit from running in this race because it'll be the first time she'll be jumping at grade one pace, and then we'll really find out whether she stays over hurdles or goes over fences. Daddy Long Legs not good enough. Sir Gerhard is on his way back, first run for since he blew out at Punchestown. Yeah, and the rest of them are in there, but they're in there to pick up pieces. So I see it as a straightforward affair, Johnny.
We have a podcast at the moment for the election, calling it with Ivan Yates and Sean Defoe.
Calling it with Jane Mangan.
And Ivan's all about... no chance. Yeah. Or it's now or never.
Yeah.
Or that person's safe.
Too dogmatic, Ivan, though. You know, you can't say it's no chance when, like, you know, I'm even giving Sinn Féin a chance now. I'm thinking that Ivan would probably say no chance. So, Saitman has an outstanding chance.
So, but can you draw a line through a load of these? I mean, I can draw a line through Brighter Days Ahead because...
No, absolutely not. She's third favourite. She's like 9-2. And Jane's point about her jumping it down Royal is valid. She's a lot to find with Saitman in every sense, but the way that they talk about her and that progress potential, she has potential to improve. But Saitman, if he hadn't raced against Constitution Hill that day at Cheltenham...
He'd be unbeaten in completed races.
He's what is he, 12...
From 13.
12 for, and he's
and a fall.
He fell early on in his career at Leopardstown. He's unbelievably reliable. Like, for to have a horse...
Here's a question for you both. Would you prefer to own Saitman or own Constitution Hill?
Ooh.
Saitman.
It's a relative thing, Jane, because if you're the Donleys, you don't need... you know, if our Michael Buckley, you're grand for cash.
You're Johnny Ward, right?
And oh, Jesus, Saitman. Saitman, yeah.
Stay you were given a gift a couple of years ago.
Money. Sorry, like, Saitman is money. How much money compared to Constitution Hill? Absolutely, Saitman, Jane. I mean, let's get to the bottom line here.
It's about filling the petrol with money.
Absolutely. It's like,
that makes no sense, but...
If I'm a multimillionaire, I might have something to think about there. And, ooh, I own Constitution Hill, and, like, we might see him run again, and is he going to the fight in fifth? Or I could own Saitman, give me the money, I'm going to pick up another 70 grand.
But also... go on.
You're both really missing the point about you're on about money, right? But to be fair, half a million of a difference. Saitman has won more than Constitution by half a million. You're missing the entertainment factor and the fact that this horse will give you so much joy.
You asked me a question. You asked me a genuine question. Like,
and unbridled joy. And I appreciate you're talking about what really matters, and he will pay for himself in training, which is vital.
But he'll never get the plaudits because Constitution Hill laughed at him the one time.
Beat him once.
Yeah, still won a champion hurdle though, Saitman. Mm. Yeah, look. Yeah, I'll be always stay on. What about Lassie Mouth? What do you think of this horse then, this mare? I know William Mullen's got the champion hurdle in mind for her next March, Jane, but only two horses aged five have won the champion hurdle in the last 40 years.
Catches. Esport Dallin, actually, is possibly my last winner. Jane, this is class now.
I would just throw into the ring there that the breed is evolving, and that statistic will change when you have more precocious French breeds.
Yeah, and more National Hunt type horses kind of running as 4-year-olds as well. Yeah,
he's five rising six, whereas, you know, I think some of the previous attempts were by horses that were off the flat bred, and they were probably at their prime as 4-year-olds in the Triumph. But yeah, she's an extraordinarily good mare. I think she's class act. I would love to see her potentially meeting Constitution Hill before March, basically to give him a hard race and also to find out whether she's good enough to run in that race in March. And then Willie Mullins would maybe have a double whammy positive effect off that. And it wouldn't surprise me if it was with Mystical Power or Lossie Mouth that Willie actually did that, that he actually threw a major dart at Constitution Hill, ruffle his feathers and keep Saitman's powder dry.
Okay. True. Who knows where? I wouldn't be surprised if Saitman if Constitution Hill didn't even rock up to Newcastle. I honestly,
just the trend for me, unless it's another sprinter sacker, Constitution Hill might not be seen that much in the race course again. just feels like that to me.
I'm hearing some suggestions today.
I'm tired of the race course gallops. I'm tired of hearing all this stuff. I just want to see Constitution Hill either at race in horse racing or not.
Yeah, and we shall see. But in relation to this race, the John Durkin, you cannot
Morgana.
Sorry, and this race and the John Durkin, you cannot underestimate having 8 or 9 runners or more in both races. It's fantastic for the race that we have each way places here. So you, if you're against 8 man, you have an alternative each way. But I would implore owners, like Jimmy Mangan was sent a very good horse by JP McManus. What owners can do about sending their horse around the country is massive. What they can also do about running horses against each other.
And on this point, we're looking at the Florida Pearl Novice Chase, Jane. 3 runners for a grade 2 race, 20 grand on Saturday, 1 o'clock at Punchestown, all owned by the same person, Michael O'Leary, and all trained by the same person, Gordon Elliott. A Stutter Story, Search for Glory and Rainbow Trail. Is that a bad, nothing against them for buying horses and running horses, but is this a bad indictment of Irish racing as an industry that you have this situation?
It's not good. It's nothing to do with the participants themselves. I do think it's a little... So the question I would ask you is, if John Ryan or Jimmy Mangan or Eddie Harty threw a 100-to-1 shot into it, does that make it any better than what it is? As in, those 3 horses are all with a very respectable rating.
It makes it better optically, but optically it looks really bad.
But I think we've had a number of cases where this has almost happened before and has effectively happened because there's a horse in there that optically makes it look better but has ultimately no chance. I would say this is also a knock-on effect of the weather that we've had. Willie Mullins is only starting to run his good novice hurdlers from last year to chase us. So we have Ballyburn half an hour before this. Had Ballyburn maybe ran 3 weeks ago, he might be in it. There's a number of occasions where just Gordon Elliott is sweeping up the beginners chases at the moment because he is the highest class hurdlers from last year, like down memory lane and those. That's why this race is the way it is. And even with Stellar Story, it's his chase debut, but he was to make a chase debut 2 weeks ago in Navan. Couldn't do it because of the ground. So the ground has been too quick ultimately for horses to compete. Grade 2, horses of that caliber to compete already. So they're not actually after getting experience in beginner's chases to run in a novice.
I'm going to give bullet points here, right? Jingletown and Gordon Elliott having 3 horses, unlike a lot of other connections, right? Against each other, they will be trying. This is a good race to look at the betting and say, listen, I actually don't think there's that much between the second and third favourite, or the favourite and the second favourite. There's an angle here. Jigginstown paid £730 for these 3 horses. All came from the point-to-point field, right? And the more I look at point-to-points, I actually don't know what they're doing for the good of national-owned racing, because they're really helping a small number of people make money from selling horses, and there's nothing to stop anyone doing that. But all of the good horses are snapped up so quickly that these horses could be somewhere else they weren't because they were bought by the big owner. And then you run them in a grade 2 on Morgiana Day at Punchestown, and the prize money is €21,500 for the winner. It's terrible. It's so bad. It should be about 40 or 50 minimum. £21,500, that's probably a factor as well. But this race, for me, it tells you a lot about where national racing is in Ireland. And I'm not really sure, I don't know what Jane thinks, I'm not really sure what value the point-to-points have at the moment for the national game as a whole.
Jane?
We discussed this 2 weeks ago, Johnny.
I wasn't here. I was in Boston. Anyway.
Just in regards to point-to-points, point-to-points have always been there. You know, a lot of people are citing the filter of talent that is Wexford at the moment, but I grew up with Robert Tyner and Liam Burke and Eugene O'Sullivan also doing the same thing, but probably to a lower level, and they were buying a cheaper type of horse. And ultimately, when I was growing up, all of those horses were going to the UK. They were going to Nichols through Barber. They were going to Henrietta Knight through Jim Lewis. So number one, I'm pleased that we are keeping the quality of horse that we are in this country, which means we can go to Cheltenham or we can go to Sandown and we can beat them. That's the first thing. The second thing is sourcing is key. We know, and we have professed before, the quality of training in this country. Training is only a very small fraction of it now. Sourcing is the biggest point. You can be the best trainer. You can be better than Willie Mullins, but you will not beat him if you don't first day start off with the best raw material. 100%. And that is up to each individual trainer. That's their prerogative.
It's like it's like the director of football at a football club. It's like, listen, I'm going to pick the team. You have to source the talent from here, and don't be spending 200 million on three duds here. Absolutely right, Jane. I like the fact that national underracing should, in theory, be you buy a store horse on looks and you take a chance on him, rather than he's already shown his hand and he's cost 300 or 400 grand. Nobody can afford him apart from two or three people. I don't think that's what national racing should be about.
Okay, let's get into this John Durkin Memorial Chase, 2:25 Sunday at Punchestown. A lot of rain forecast, so probably could be soft ground by the time it goes to post. 9 runners. This is unbelievable, folks. I know I'm prone to hyperbole, but it actually is true this time. So Gallop on des Chances, dual Cheltenham Gold Cup winner, is declared, as is Fast or Slow, who won the race last year and has won 2 Gold Cups at Punchestown. Grange Clare West is a course and distance winner. Fact to File, William Mullins thinks this horse is going right to the top. Florida Pearl, Rouge have gone straight over fences, won the novice race at Cheltenham last March. I still rated those £17 behind Gallop on des Chances. Blue Lord is in there. I know the way you're thinking, won at Cheltenham. Journey with Me for Henry de Bramhead, Manelica Cooner, a staying type. And then your family's horse, Bland's Tower, Jane, proved from his first run last season and then won the big Gold Cup at Ferry House. First of all, how's Jimmy in terms of his mood with Bland's Tower? Are y'all happy?
Yeah, I think he's just pleased to get him started. There's been no secrets made that he wanted to get him out before now, and he wanted to get more work into him before now. But he, I think, only got him on grass for the first time this week. This time last year, Splans Tower had actually ran twice. So that kind of tells you where we are in our schedule. And the options were go to Haydock, go to the Fortria by dropping back to 2 miles the other day. They found a 50 race, or come here. And we said, why not? We want to get him started without giving him a 3 mile slog around Haydock. And we didn't think it was the right thing to do to go back to 2 miles with hopefully the aim in the spring being either a Ryanair or a Gold Cup. So
how does that work, Jane, between the trainer and the owner then? Because so JP is kind of happy to go with what your dad is saying in relation to his starting point.
No, I wouldn't say so. I'd say it's completely JP and Frank.
Okay.
Dad gives his opinion, but obviously they have...
That's like, fine. That's how it should be. They own the horse. They pay the bills.
They have so many of the similar types. Yeah. So they obviously had Capodanno supplemented for Haydock. They had Limerick Lace, and they have 3 in here. So they have remarkable talent in this category. And I am blown away by the fact that Spillane's Tower is the lowest rated horse in this
Unbelievable.
Race.
Unbelievable. He's rated 155, right? He's 24 pounds off the favourite.
Yeah. I've taken a look at the Haydock race, and Grey Dawning is 11-4 favourite for Haydock. Mm. He's rated £2 superior to Spillane's Tower.
Unbelievable.
And if they were meeting, I would be very confident. I just think the two races are in different leagues, Premier League and Junior B. This John Durkin, this is the King George.
And there's far, far better prize money at Haydock again. Far better prize money. So it was an option. Jane has summed it up well. This race has... I know the way you're thinking, who could well win the Gold Cup. I see 20-1 William Hill for him for this race. Now he's run over a trip that, is probably short for his best. What goes off favourite?
We're looking at the moment, Fact to File and Fast or Slow, 2-1 joint favourites with Hill.
Gallop and Deschamps is always odds on, and here he could be third favourite.
7-2, yeah.
Yeah, it's incredible.
How'd you see it?
Fast or Slow, I'd be a little bit worried about the ground turning very, very soft. Other than that, it's very much price dependent. Fact to File for me, I'm still slightly jury out on him as to how good he is. I'm being honest now, at the prices I'd be with Gallop and Deschamps, because you don't get... Fair enough, he was beaten in the race last year, but they'll have that in their head as well. He's getting on a bit, so let's do our best to win as many races as we can. He was 1-2 in the race last year, fair enough, and he was running on at the finish. I'd be more forgiven of the end of the season race. I think at the end of the season he's had a long season, but at the prices I still feel he's going to run well.
Well, 2 years ago he won it very easily. Does he need to go from the front, Jane, Gallop on des Chances, because he wasn't last year under Paul Townend?
Yeah, I think he'll jump off to make the running, John, but I don't think he jumps fast enough to stay there. That was the intention at the festival last April, and a conflated went on after the second fence. Faster Slow, Derek O'Connor would be ideal for him, because he's a really quick horse through the air, and he won't want him to over race. Factofile, here's a quiz question for the pair of you. Factofile is bidding to become the first horse since who to win a Grade 1 novice chase at the Cheltenham Festival and then follow up in the John Durkin.
Missed that?
Nope.
Florida Pearl?
Florida Pearl, 2001.
Yeah.
A very
wasn't
long
even born,
time
Jane.
Ago.
Yeah, that's why, because Florida Pearl went straight from the bumper, which he won at Cheltenham.
Has he missed that?
Yeah. To fences and miss the hurdles, and when you see that,
I don't get why all these horses go hurdling when they're chasers. Like, why are you wasting time here? I think more should do it.
What do you think of the? How do you assess the race then, Jane, in terms of who might win it?
Well, if I'm honest, the only horses I can rule out with any great confidence is Manila Cocooner, Blue Lord, and Journey With Me, because I don't see any of the three of them winning either a Ryanair or a Gold Cup. Each and every other horse thereafter could be a stable star for anyone. The most overpriced horse in the race, and I think it's because he's forgotten, is Grange Clare West.
Yes, yeah. I agree completely.
Go back and watch that defeat when he beat Corbett's Cross and Flooring Porter at Leopardstown at Christmas. He absolutely annihilated them. And now it's just because I think it's recency bias or their lack of. He hasn't raced since December. He's somewhere around 18 or 20 to 1. I think that's a ridiculous price. I agree with Johnny on it, the way you're thinking. I think he's probably a Grand National horse. He may well be a Gold Cup horse, but he's very slow from the back of his fences. Go back to Aintree and watch where he looked like he was going to be beaten and he just stays on really well. Our horse is going to need the run, so I don't expect him to be winning this.
I think Jane's onto a good point here with Grange Clare West.
I completely agree. Yeah. I watched the race about an hour ago, Jane. I was there at Leopardstown. Absolutely. Just pulled Paul Tynan's arms out for 3 miles. Course and distance winner. Was never a hurdler. Definitely a chaser. First run of the season. But a lot of these are having their first run of the season. I think definitely need to try a chance.
You can have 7 or 8 lads in the pub. And last season, they're like, we could make a case for it. We'll argue the point here. This horse is overpriced, that horse is overpriced. This race has everything.
No, I agree with you as well, Johnny, that I think Galopin is the best value. I think Grange Clare West, for me, is the best each-way value.
Yeah.
Jane, any kind
18 to 1 top price, William Hill.
Different?
Yeah, that's kind of how I sum it up. I was just going to go through the rest of them. I think our horse will need the run. Very happy that Jack Kennedy is available to ride him. I wasn't sure when we saw declarations this morning who that would be. Galopin de Champ shouldn't be third favourite because he's the best horse in the race. But I think there's a majesty about getting behind a novice, and that is Factofile. Factofile does not deserve to be shorter than Galopin de Champ. Beating Monty Star is not better than beating Jerry Colomb in a Gold Cup.
Also needed the run last year as well.
He's like 17 pounds. He's a 40. Yeah. He's load of weight to find with him.
He also needed the run last year, first time out.
I think as a general rule, novices are too short a price.
Agreed.
I go back to Grey Dawning.
Yeah.
Should not be he might win the Bedford Chase, but he should not be favoured for it. And I just can't get away from the form of fast or slow in a Punchestown in Punchestown. I think that's where he's best. So he for me is the most likely winner, fast or slow.
Just before we let you go, Jane, who will win the Bedford Chase then?
Grey Dawning.
I think Hoyt Senor is overpriced.
Right.
He can't win. Surely not.
Well, they're happy with him now.
Is on the
they're happy with him now.
They're happy. Like, this race, it's a tough one, Jane.
And the other one, Augusto Rodan, is in the Japan Cup. Does he have any chance for a swan song for our Aidan O'Brien on Sunday?
As the theory goes, he'll either win or finish nowhere. I've just never seen Aidan O'Brien go to Japan. I've never seen him. He's had runners out there before. He's out there with this horse. And I'd say in a nation where racing is like Formula One or Premier League, I'd say Aidan O'Brien's getting like papped like Beyonce over there. He's apparently, this is going to be it. This has been the aim probably since he blew out in the King George. And if that Irish Champion Stakes is as good as I thought it was, I hope he runs a huge race. Because if he doesn't, the Japanese are going to be looking at us thinking, God, your racing isn't great because this guy won a Derby and he won an Irish Champion Stakes and he nearly won an Irish Champion Stakes and we're able to eat you. So I hope he runs with credit. I also think that Goliath is an overpriced horse because, again, it's been a while since the King George and the people maybe forgotten how good he is.
The next time Jimmy Mangan has a JP McManus-owned horse, like perhaps like Beyonce, IRE, you know it's good, right? Because Jane named it here. And it could be, who knows, it could be a full brother to Splendid Star or whatever, who knows?
Jane, thanks so much.
Thanks, guys. Enjoy.
Okay, that's Jane Mangan there, William Hill ambassador and former jockey and current Brilliant. Brilliant analysis.
She was a proper, proper amateur rider. I remember her starting off riding for Derma Weld and riding for various people, riding Galway for Derma Weld, and always liked her style and still do.
Brilliant broadcaster. This is Racing Pod and Off the Ball. If you're listening to the free version of the podcast, we're leaving you here. But if you're looking for more, including our look at some of the shoulder races at Punchestown, Saturday's big one at Haydock, and the two big ones at Ascot, and Johnny's charity bet as well. So much to come. Go to offtheball.com/join to subscribe and get the full podcast with all of our racing tips, insights, and stories from the week's action.